Hi everyone, welcome.
Want to see you.
Oh,
well, hello, hello
everyone.
We're gonna hold for a couple minutes to see who else meanders in. Hi, Caroline. Hope everyone's enjoying their Wednesday. Staying cozy.
I feel like we should plug the Mad Festival and the Emory Dance Company and the KSU Dance Company are all happening this weekend. There's all of the online dance, and then Kit Modus has a in-person show this Saturday. So go see all the dance.
Lots and lots of dance. Yeah, congrats, Caroline, on the new job.
Thank you.
What's the new job?
It's like with software consulting in Denver. Exciting stuff.
That's lovely. Sorry, I just got a Kristen O'Neill sighting. It was great.
Hey, Sammy. Cool. Let's hold maybe 2 more minutes and then we'll get started.
Yeah, to like 5 after.
Yeah.
I see David Tattoo's name, but he won't turn his video on. How am I supposed to see the new haircut?
I've got you up on my TV. So I can have you nice and large, and I'm not quite sure how to get the camera part to work. So defeated by technology, but I'll post a Facebook picture of the haircut.
We'll be looking forward to it.
Thanks. If things go slow here, I'll see what I can do.
Okay.
And then, hi, Catherine. I don't know if we've met.
Yeah, I'm here. I'm actually working on with David Tattoo on some production stuff for the dance department, so that's why I'm here. So
cool, thanks for joining us. Nice to meet you.
Yeah, nice to meet y'all.
There's also insights and ingredients this weekend if anyone wants to do an in-person choreographic workshop. That's Saturday and Sunday, I believe, over at the Movement Lab with Room to Move Dance.
Oh yeah, I did know that.
Lots going on. Check the Dance ATL calendar.
So many things. Terminus still has a show out there in the world until November 21st, I think, is when it's a world premiere from Anna Maria. Super good show.
Hey, Anya. Thanks for coming. Also, Stave Dance released a podcast today.
Yeah.
Called Secret Architecture, so that's out.
So many things.
All right. More folks are coming in. About 20 more seconds and we'll get started.
Jackie, I can keep an eye on the waiting room as well because I have permission to admit people, I think. So
sweet. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah, totally.
All right. In that case, it's basically 5:05 now. So let's get started. welcome, everyone. My name is Jackie. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and I'm the operations manager of Dance ATL. Thank you for spending your Wednesday afternoon with us for our tech talk on stage management. For those of you who are new to Dance ATL, I'd love to quickly share what we do. We are a dance service organization here in Atlanta. We are a fiscally sponsored nonprofit and have applied for 501c3 status. Our mission is to nurture and promote dance as a vibrant part of Atlanta's arts ecosystem. We connect artists to resources, grow and engage audiences in the city, and support the full range of the industry by cultivating an awareness and appreciation of dance that is sustainable and expansive. Before we continue, I want to begin acknowledging that we are on the traditional ancestral unceded territory of Lower Muscogee Creek and Eastern Board of Cherokee Peoples. We would also like to acknowledge our intersectionality and honor members of the disability, LGBTQ, Indigenous, Black, and Brown communities already prone to violence who have been disproportionately affected by the COVID-19 pandemic. And to support a full creative life for all, Dance ATL commits to championing policies and practices that empower a just, inclusive, equitable community. So Tech Talk is a series that Greg Catalier, Heather Pine, and Joe Futral has gifted us. So last season, we had 3 Tech Talks that included general production, lighting design, and sound design using QLab. And as we expand our series, please let us know what else you may be interested in the future for Tech Talks. So you can email Greg or Scott, who are our production committee chairs, at production@danceatl.org. A couple of quick housekeeping notes. As you can see, we are recording this for those who cannot attend. So we will be posting this on like our platform. So you are welcome to turn off your video if you are not comfortable. Also, please keep yourself muted during the presentation. There will be moments throughout where Angelina and Sharon will pause and ask for questions, as well as a Q&A session at the end. So you're welcome to unmute yourself at those points. You're also welcome to use the chat box and ask questions throughout. Scott will be fielding them, so he is there for tech support as well if you're having any difficulties. Just send a message in the chat. Okay, that's all for me. That was a lot. I'm going to pass the baton over to Scott.
Hey, y'all. My name is Scott Wheat. My pronouns are he, him, his. As Jackie mentioned, I am the co-chair of the production committee for Dance ATL, along with Greg Catalier. In the community, I'm also a production manager for Core Dance. And at the end of the day, after all that, I'm also a movement artist. I will be virtually kind of moderating and watching the chat. So if you have any questions, feel free to just hit me up privately or publicly for Q&A at the end.
All right. Do either of you have anything else before we jump in? Great. Okay. So I'm going to share a screen with you guys. Great. Can everybody see this? Cool. So first of all, thank you, Jackie. Thank you to Dance ATL for having us. We're excited to give this talk about stage management for dance. And thank you, Scott, for being here to support us as well. So today we're going to talk about stage management for dance from the perspective of mostly choreographers, artistic directors, the people that will be hiring stage managers is the lens that we're looking at it today. If that's not you, don't worry. There will still be plenty of pertinent information. And feel free to ask questions at the end when we go to a Q&A, and also feel free to drop questions in the chat as we go. And we'll definitely answer them. And Jackie will also share this PowerPoint with you all with the recording after it's over. So we're going to start by introducing my colleague, Sharon Kerlock.
Hello, everyone. Thank you again to Jackie and Jancy CEO for having us and hosting this. We really hope that you guys get some useful information from us from this tech talk. And gosh, my stage managing experience started as a freelance artist, freelance stage manager. I did a lot of things with a lot of Atlanta-based artists in the city before getting my MFA, and then worked with a lot of organizations like Emory Dance, Moving in the Spirit, before working at Core Dance as a production manager for about 3 years. And now I'm in a whole different arena, working at the CDC. It's almost kind of like stage managing on a different level, especially at this time in history. And I'm definitely grateful for the skills that I have, and I'm excited to share a little bit of my knowledge with you.
Thank you. So my name is Angelina Polini. I started out as a dancer, grew up studying ballet. Then I went to KSU and graduated with a BA in dance. But while I was there, I ended up in a production class with David Tattoo and accidentally fell in love with working backstage. And I ended up pursuing stage management. And so now I am a freelance stage manager in Atlanta. I'm the resident stage manager for Emory University's dance program, which is where I am right now in the Schwartz Center. And then I also, like I said, I freelance for a lot of different dance companies, mostly a few theater companies around town, from Terminus Modern Ballet Theater to the Atlanta Ballet, Full Radius Dance, all kinds of different projects around town. And I still teach dance as well. So let's get into it. Our first talking point today is going to be, what do stage managers do? So as it turns out, there isn't exactly an easy answer to this question. There's not one codified definition of what a stage manager is or what a stage manager does. There's actually a lot of talk among stage managers. I have conversations all the time with stage managers all over the country and all over the world, trying to figure out, what is our job? What is it not? And the reason for that is that it really greatly depends on the company, and it changes a lot from each company to each show. A lot of times it's really not the same for anyone. And it depends a lot on the size of the company, the culture of the company, how many employees they have. And it also differs a lot based on the genre. So a dance stage manager doesn't necessarily do the same thing that a theater stage manager would do, or that you would do for an opera or a concert. Those jobs actually look surprisingly different, even though we're all sort of accomplishing the same thing. And also depends on the type of the contract. So you have freelance contracts, full-time contracts. Oftentimes, like as a freelancer, I'll sign a contract to do a show with a company, and it's just a singular show. So that contract has a start date and an end date, and that is, so once the show's over, I am done. Other times, like I'll sign on to be the resident stage manager for a company, so I'm contracted for their full season. It's more of like a part-time position. And then other situations, you'll have a full-time stage manager, and like Sharon at Core was the full-time production manager. And Sharon can also talk a little bit more about the difference between a stage manager, a production stage manager, and a production manager. So that also has a lot to do with what responsibilities fall where. Sharon.
Yeah. I would have to say that the contract is the most important thing that you want to look at when you are hiring a stage manager. What responsibilities you want them to do, what roles that you want to take on, who else in your organization is there. For example, as a production manager for Core Dance, I took care of a lot of the
things that happen before we would get into the performance space. A lot of hiring a crew, a lot of gathering, acquiring props, a lot of the things that sometimes a stage manager or a production stage manager would do if a production manager wasn't present. So really take a moment to think about the responsibilities, think about what you're asking, and then take a look at some of the job descriptions that are posted online at different dance companies to see if you're asking, you know, this person to be a stage manager, a production stage manager, or a production manager.
Yeah. So, but you get the idea that it can be a little different every time. And so maybe not everybody knows exactly what a stage manager does. But we've all encountered a stage manager at some point, most likely if you're here now. So the question we want to ask you guys is, what do you think of when you think of a stage manager? What does a stage manager do in your mind? And you can either, if anybody wants to chime in, either unmute yourself or you could drop it in the chat and just tell us, what do you think a stage manager does? And what comes to mind first? Somebody answer me.
It looks like in the chat we say giving call times.
Getting call times. Perfect. Okay. And what else? What else?
Looks like call cues.
Call cues. Perfect. That's totally what you think of when you think of a stage manager, right?
Put up the sign-in sheet. Take notes throughout the rehearsal process. At least a lot of good answers.
Yeah, a lot of good answers. And that is totally what most people think of when they think of a stage manager. They call the show. They often keep track of time. You hear a stage manager calling half hour. But as it turns out, there's actually a lot more to calling to stage managing than just calling a show. Like we said, it's a little different every time. But like here, you can see this long list is an example of like what I would do if I were the PSM for, say, a full radio show. I made this list thinking about sort of a smaller sized company, maybe mid-sized company that doesn't have a separate production manager. This is sort of an example of at least most of the things that I would take on as a PSM. And it's important to know that there are a lot of things that stage managers do beyond just calling the show, especially thinking about in times of COVID where you may not have cues to call. Like, we're doing a lot of site-specific work now where maybe you don't necessarily think that you need a stage manager. You're like, well, what would a stage manager really do for me? Like, if we're not in a traditional show setting. But as you can see, there are still a lot of things that apply. And I've, you know, even during this time where we haven't been able to necessarily be in a theater in a traditional sense, like, stage management is still very much applicable in a lot of ways to keep your show organized. So this is kind of an overwhelming list. So we're going to walk through it step by step and sort of take it in sections and talk about this example, keeping in mind that it could change for different types of positions and different situations.
So before you get to the space, before load in, before the performance, there's a lot of things that happens on the top end. And some of you have given these answers. The stage manager schedules production meetings with the designers, with the artist director, or the choreographer. The stage manager can watch rehearsals in the studio. And sometimes that stage manager is at the very first rehearsal at the beginning of the artistic process. Sometimes the stage manager can come in one to three rehearsals before load in, before tech week. Different strokes for different situations. The stage manager can communicate with the venue and assess needs with designers. The stage manager will create a production schedule, which Angelina has a few examples for you. We're going to talk about that. A stage manager can hire crew. Also, a production manager could hire crew. So again, make sure you're looking at that contract. And the stage manager will create labor materials, and labor and material budgets, and possibly collect music to create a QLab file. Or back in my day, while I think I might be telling my age a little bit, we would create a music file and burn CDs. But I guess, you know, we've come up with the times. So again, Angelina has a couple of examples for you, and she's going to show you what a sample production schedule looks like.
Yeah, so this is a sample production schedule that I made for a show that never happened, because of COVID. And yeah, so it has, as you can see, it's very detailed. Always have the location and the address at the top. And it tells the crew exactly what we're doing and where they need to be when, and lists out exactly every person that needs to be there and what we'll be doing each day. As we get more into tech, it becomes even more detailed. And then as we would get into a show, it would become even more so. It would have things like mop calls on there, and say exactly when the day ends. So the production schedule is really about having as much detail as possible for me, versus a dancer schedule. This would be what I would send out to the company or the cast. And I think what's important about dancer schedules is to have only the information that they need and nothing extra. So I really like to keep the production schedule and the dancer schedule separate, so that the dancers aren't having to dig through the production schedule to see, like, get confused, mop call, dancer call, when do I need to be there? So that's that.
And here's an example of a labor budget. And when I was a production manager, this was one of the things that I would be in charge of. And since Angelina does a lot of production stage management work, she's in charge of it. And it's pretty much broken down basically how you would see a budget. Everybody has their hourly calls. They know when they're coming in. So each day might be different. Each person might be called on a different day at a different time. And note that cannot exceed number in the corner in red. It's very important that when you're presented with a budget as a stage manager, or you're presenting your budget to your stage manager, that they know, hey, I need to hire this many people for my crew, and I need to pay them an hourly wage. They need to work so many hours that I can't exceed this particular number. And then there's also a different number for board ops. And then there's also the number that, you know, the production stage manager gets paid themselves. So it's definitely that conversation between the artistic director or the choreographer and the stage manager on all of these points, so that you can meet that goal, you can match that number, you can not exceed what is being presented, and there's fewer headaches at the end. And before we keep moving forward, I just want to check and make sure that there's not any questions in the chat box about what we've covered so far. And Scott, I saw your nod, so I'm gonna see that that's good. Okay.
Yeah, I think the budget's also a really helpful tool for especially shows that are happening year after year. If you have something that's annual, or even if you just know, hey, this is usually how much we spend on our yearly rep show. It's really helpful to give you a sense of looking back at your budget. It's helpful to have this to be able to plan for future shows. This sample budget that you see here is from the Mad Festival, and every year we do the Mad Festival, and every year I look back at the budget for the year prior, and it makes planning the next one way easier. So then we get to load in and tech. So for some contracts, this could be the first time you're coming in contact with the company. A lot of times I get hired as a stage manager after all of the stuff we just talked about has already happened. So it really just depends. Sometimes tech is the first time I'm seeing the work, which is also something that is specific to dance, whereas usually theater stage managers are much more involved in the rehearsal process. A lot of times dance stage managers aren't. But this is really where the dance stage manager duties kick in. So a lot of times if you are the production manager or a PSM, you'll be involved in leading the load-in, and that's in conjunction with the master electrician or technical director. Again, if you're strictly just the stage manager and there's a separate production manager, load-in would just mean loading in your pieces. So, you know, stage management things like directional signs for people to find dressing rooms or green rooms, or, you know, making sure you have your first aid kit ready. And then, so after load-in and before dancers arrive, it's the duty of the stage manager to make sure that the space is safe, no matter what that space is. If we're in the theater, that means making sure that the stage is safe and there's no loose nails or sawdust on the floor, and making sure that, you know, backstage cables are taped down and there's nothing to trip on, you know, sharp things are marked with white tape, or in a site-specific location, you also have to look out for safety, making sure that if we're performing in a parking lot, there's no broken glass, and warning people of those types of things. And then especially important for dance, stage managers make sure that the floor is ready, that they may not be the ones themselves cleaning it, but they at least make sure that the stage is getting mopped and getting mopped appropriately, that it's not too slick and not too sticky. And that's before class, before rehearsals, before shows. Stage managers also make sure that the dressing rooms are ready and that they're assigned. That's important with big companies, especially if you have a big group of dancers that have never been in the space before. Also making sure that they can find the dressing rooms, and making sure that they're ready. So if your tech writer stipulates that each dancer needs 2 feet of space and a mirror, the stage manager is going to be the one looking and making sure that those needs have been met. I've walked into venues before where the green room is packed with furniture and you have to shuffle things. Scott's smiling because he knows exactly what I'm talking about. So we make sure that's taken care of. And then we get into tech, and that's the real meat and potatoes of stage management work. So as we're figuring out these production elements and the shows really come into life, the stage manager is going to track every lighting cue, every sound cue, rail cues, video cues. We're going to keep track of props and wardrobe needs, gel changes, everything that needs to happen to make the show run. And then you're going to take that information and culminate it into a cue sheet of cues that need to be called by the stage manager. And then often adapting paperwork for ASMs, assistant stage managers, to run everything that needs to happen backstage. So sometimes it looks like this. ASM paperwork run sheets can also all look very different. It's really based on your show's needs. And often I create this for ASMs. A lot of times ASMs also create their own paperwork. Again, it really depends on the show. But a lot of times I would give an ASM that looks something like this. Again, this was an example from the MAD Festival. So all of these things here are gel colors. So this was the color that they were putting in the booms for each piece. So they were either the ASMs in charge of it, or the ASM would be in charge of making sure that a stagehand did that. Then you've got you can see the Black Traveler was opening and closing at some points during the piece. If there were any props, things like that would be noted on a sheet like this. Different audio needs, what have you, anything that's happening backstage would be covered on this sheet.
So it is showtime, and the performance is about to happen. You're finally here. And I just want to take a second and note all of the things that had to happen with your stage manager before you get to this point. All of the paperwork that's involved, all of the meetings, all of the rehearsal, all of that interaction time that you've had with this person who is calling your show before they actually call your show. And even before then, the stage manager will communicate with whoever is in the front of house. That could be box office, that could be your front of house manager, that could be the table that everybody comes to at the park to get their tickets before they pull out their blanket and sit down before they watch the performance. All of that communication happens through the stage manager while the stage manager is also communicating with everything that's happening behind the stage, making sure the performers are in place, making sure all of the cues are clean, making sure the backstage is clean, making sure everybody has their deck sheets, their run cues, everybody has their gels, so that everything is in place before you call the show. And then after the show comes down, there is something called a post-mortem meeting where they collect all of the notes, the cue sheets, everything that we've talked about before, making sure that everybody's on the same page so that if the show goes up again, especially if it's a festival or a recital or if it's a touring performance, or even if that's the last time the show ever happens, it's good to have that moment with everybody to kind of culminate the whole experience. So we're going to get into the cue sheet. This is a pretty clear example of what that looks like. And the cue sheet has everything, lighting, sound, any kind of, like if it's a house with rails and you're flying in scenery, that goes into the cue sheet. Moments to call dancers to places, moments for your ASM and all your backstage crew to change gel, when to call, you know, 15 minutes till 10 minutes, 5 minutes, all of that's on the cue sheet. And then you have your standby, and then you have your GO.
Yeah. So as Sharon said, this is a pretty standard example of a cue sheet. This is, I think, a cue sheet that I made for an Off the Edge performance. But it's also not necessarily the only way to call a show. There are lots of other ways of making your paperwork. Some people call from a score if it's a show that has a musical score. You know, you might call a play from a script. This is just one way. This is a way that I typically like to call a show if I can. One of the things that I really like about calling a show in this format is this what column. I think it's something that's important to keep track of. So I'm looking at this and I know that I call like you 100 when the dancers are ready backstage. That's when I'm going to call it. But I think it's also important to note that what that looks like. So in this what column, I know that that's the curtain warmers going out. So if I call like you 100 and I don't see the curtain warmers go out, that lets me know I shouldn't call the next cue. I don't need to take the curtain out until the warmers are out. And I think it's important to be aware of not only when to call your cues, but what they are, and being aware of why you're calling them when you're calling them, and not always just being head down in your book, calling cues and hoping that the show is going by. But no matter what format your cue sheet is in, it's really important to have every piece of information that you need to make the show successful written out in your paperwork. So you can see this tab down here. We won't show it, but I also always have a pre-show and a post-show checklist. So the cue sheet's telling you everything that needs to happen during the show, but it's also important to have a running list of all the things that you yourself need to do before and after the show. And that's so that, you know, the saying we always like to use is that if you get hit by a bus, you know, something, if there's an emergency, somebody else needs to be able to pick up your paperwork and make the show run just as smoothly as you can. So you can't be hiding any of that information in your memory. Another good example, another David Tattoo anecdote that he instilled in me early on was that it's also helpful for yourself if you, you know, inevitably you're going to be running in late one day and you're going to spill coffee and somebody cuts you off in traffic and you're going to be really stressed coming in. And if you have really good paperwork that's all laid out, the show's still going to run smoothly because you don't have to think about what you're doing and make sure that you didn't miss anything, because you're going to check off your checklist and physically make sure that you've hit absolutely everything that you needed to do.
It's also the note that all of the paperwork that we're talking about is it's not just capturing the nitty gritty grind of the show. In a way, you're kind of capturing the memory of that show, the experience of that show. And I'm gonna use this MFA show report as an example. This is a typical performance report that will happen. At the end of the show, the stage manager would write down who was there, write down the schedule of the day, the events, kind of what happened. They write down whether or not there was traffic. They like write down local weather. And it's like, well, why is traffic so important? Okay, well, there was an accident on 85 and half of your audience is stuck in traffic. And that's why the show started late. So it's not just like such and so person was out of their light, which is also very important, but it's almost kind of like a recall, a memory. And this one's pretty important to me, this show report. This is actually the show report for my MFA concert. It was the second performance and my family was in town. And they were running late. And I don't know, if you could squint, you can see that the start time is at 8:12. And the reason for that is the stage manager, Rachel Hunter, did everything that she could so that my family wouldn't miss my piece, which was first in the show. And I think she tells me that they were lowering themselves into the seats as like right at the end of the pre-show announcement. And so, yes, this show report captured, you know, the important details, but it also captured that memory. Every time I look at it, I always think about the wonderful thing that the stage manager did for me that I did not expect, I did not ask for, and I pretty much cherish. Speaking of things to ask and what to expect from your stage manager, I think it would be a good time to talk about what not to expect your stage manager to do.
Yeah, and talking about reports, it's also important to note the logistical use of a report and how important it is to actually read your report every night if your stage manager sends one, as they should. Like you'll see in the scenic section of this one, it says the scrim looks a little high on stage left. So that's helpful because the scenic designer may not be at every show and they're probably going to read that and say, well, we need to fix that before the show tomorrow. Because often when a little thing goes wrong in a show, the rest of the show goes well, and you may, you know, if you're in the audience, you may be thinking to yourself, like, oh, we need to fix that tomorrow. But by the time the show comes down and you get home, we come in tomorrow, you forget. And that's really a helpful part of having a show report and a stage manager that's keeping track of all those little things so that those things can get fixed and we can have an even better show the next day. And the same goes for things that involve the dancers. We may put notes in the report that need to be iterated to the dancer. So it's also really important to read the report every night and make sure that we're implementing the changes for the next day. So, like Sharon said, there are some things that you should not expect a dance stage manager to do. So because the definition of a stage manager and the roles of a stage manager, as we've talked about so much, can change, oftentimes it's easy to not really know where to draw lines with a stage manager, and you hire them and you're not exactly sure what they should be doing and what they're not supposed to be doing. So there are a few, like, I listed a few common examples of things that people often may think of, things that they could ask the stage manager to do, that you don't necessarily mean to be taking advantage of a stage manager, but these are things that you shouldn't necessarily assume unless they're explicitly talked about in a contract. So things like load in and load out labor. While your stage manager is usually going to be at the load in and the load out, and they may be managing the people, you also want to make sure that you hire adequate crew and you're not necessarily expecting them to complete the load in and the load out labor. Sometimes they're happy to jump in, other times they're not. Like, it's just something you need to talk about in a contract. Self-running the consoles. You may think, well, the stage manager is saying go, why don't they just hit go themselves? There are a lot of reasons to have board ops, and they're a valuable part of the show as well. There are times when it's beneficial for the stage manager to run their own console. It's just a conversation that you should have. Laundry and wardrobe should usually be taken care of by somebody else. And then any type of design, lighting design, sound design, projection design, those aren't things that you should assume a stage manager should do unless you specifically hire, like, a lighting designer to design the show and they're also going to call it. But that's sort of a different situation. And we just really want to respect everyone's jobs and make sure that, you know, we're valuing our designers and, you know, our wardrobe crew and stuff like that as well. But always talk to your stage manager, because a lot of times I am happy to set up a QLab file, even if it's not necessarily a stage management role, or a lot of times it is beneficial for me to go myself and we don't really need a board up. But you just shouldn't assume, and make sure that you're writing out contracts clearly and also paying people adequately for what they're doing. So now you know what a stage manager does, but why do you need somebody to do all of these things? Why are these things important?
So stage managers are important because they help everything run smoothly, and they make people feel really good and really comfortable in the space. And a lot of those fine details, those nitty gritty moments that as a choreographer or artist director, you're focusing on your work, you're focusing on making sure all of the experiences that you want the audience to have during your performance, they happen. You're having that one-on-one time with your dancers. So the stage manager is taking care of all of the other things so that you can focus on your art. They're also looking out for you. They're looking out for rules and guidelines of the space. A lot of times, you know, stage managers are there to check, you know, the space to make sure it's clean at the end, making sure those things that you just might not have time to think about. You know, you're running out after the performance to greet everybody who saw your piece, and stage manager is still there making sure that the crew knows what to do, how to break down the show. And the stage manager is also keeping track of time, both in giving calls and, you know, on a broader scale, making sure that the schedule of the performance from, you know, tech week all the way up until everything comes down, all of those times are met. And timing is a very important part of a stage manager. There was a saying when I was growing up, To be early is to be on time, to be on time is to be late, and to be late is to be sorry. And I kind of carry that with me, and I really didn't understand the idea of timing and being on time until I had to call my first blackout cue. And it's really important that you land that exactly. I mean, obviously you don't want to be late. That's very bad. But sometimes early isn't the best decision in that situation either. So now it's, you know, to be early is to be early. To be on time is to be on time. And timing is important. And, you know, to be late, you know, I'm so sorry. But you definitely want to allow yourself to engage with someone who has taken the time to hone that skill, to hone the idea of time. And that's what a stage manager does.
Yeah. So really what we're trying to say is that this is really like a position that should be valued, that what stage managers do really is important. So when you're looking at your budget and you're saying, well, do we really need to hire a stage manager? Like, can I call the cues myself as the artistic director? Can I, you know, have the dancer that's injured do it? There really is value whenever you can to hiring a professional stage manager. So you know that you want to, you know what stage managers do, you know why it's important, so you want to hire a stage manager. So what should you look for? The thing is that as we've talked about how stage managers can be really different, they also have different skill sets. So there are some things that are similar for traits that all stage managers should have, but they can also be really different. So a stage manager that is fantastic for opera may not be the best stage manager for dance or for a play. But good organization and communication skills are paramount for all stage managers. It really takes a detail-oriented person to carry out a smooth show, so that's always something you want to look for. And then for dance, you really want somebody that understands the show from all angles. Somebody who can talk to designers and choreographers efficiently. Ideally, you want your stage manager to have a broader understanding of production so that they understand what's going on at every moment of the show, so that they can communicate with the designers effectively, so that when something goes wrong, they understand why, and they know either how to fix it or who to talk to and how to communicate the problem. And again, that goes back to also really if you understand the cues that you're calling and you know why you're calling the cues when you're calling them, you're always going to call them more accurately. And then your stage manager doesn't necessarily need to be a dancer or a former dancer, but they should have an understanding of dance. That's going to be important to understand general vocabulary, structure, the culture of dance, and how a dance show works. You know, you have a fantastic stage manager that works in theater, but if they don't know what rosin is or what Marley is, you might get through, but it'll be tough. Communication will be harder. And familiarity with timing and music is really important for calling cues for dance as well. And then there's this need to be able to anticipate and this instinct that good dance stage managers need. And it's important for dance because dance so often is different every show. Especially if you're working with like an improv-based company. So say you're calling a show and there is an improvisational score where a dancer is repeating the same movement over and over and over again. And eventually they're going to break out of that repetition and you need to call a lighting cue at exactly the moment they break out of that repetition. So they may do it differently every night. So you can't sit there with a stopwatch and, you know, just say go when you're expecting them to do it. Because even if the choreography is set, dancers get off, things happen. It's never guaranteed to be the same twice. So you really need somebody that has the instincts and the experience experience to be able to be there in that moment with the dancer and just feel it and know exactly when they're about to break out of that, so you are prepared to call that cue at exactly the right moment. So it's important to find somebody that has those skills.
Yeah, I actually have a story for that. As a production manager, I was we were at a show. It was in this warehouse museum, and we were running the show off of generators. And one of the generators stopped during the performance, and we only had half our lights. And it was at a moment where the dancers were in a particular part of the space that wasn't lit. And, you know, it's my job as a production manager to fix whatever is going on. So I'm running around the space with our TV, our technical director, Hudson Davis at the time. And we're like trying to crank this generator up. The stage manager, Kristen O'Neill, at that moment, I think she took out her cell phone and turned on the flashlight on her cell phone, walked over to that darkly, dimly lit space, and prompted everybody to pull out their cell phones and turn on their flashlights. And there's still people who think that that was a part of the performance. And eventually, you know, we got the lights going, but it was that good instinct. It was that moment of not panicking and trusting that, you know, hey, I can figure this out. And it may not necessarily be the same as the performance from the night before, but it is a performance that no one ever forgot. And the show went on, and it was a success instead of an epic failure.
Yeah, and I mean, that's live theater. Things like that are always going to happen. I mean, we all have our war stories of, you know, the time that the cabinet didn't make it on stage during the final moments of the Nutcracker. And, you know, it's a good stage manager can be the difference in, a, like you said, a show-stopping failure or a smooth recovery. And that's why you really want to hire somebody that you trust, because ultimately you're leaving your show with them, and it's up to them in those moments where things don't go as planned that you need a stage manager that can save it. And you also want to hire somebody that you respect and you enjoy working with. Which,
so you get to the point where you're wanting to hire the stage manager, you wanted to hire this excellent person that we've been talking about. And before we get into this, I just want to check in again with Scott. Are we still good on questions?
No questions as of yet, but okay. Except from Greg, who is wondering where that photo from Emery was from.
It was a workroom showcase. It was a rehearsal from workroom. I can't remember what year it was. But it was like, I don't know if you can see in the corner, that's Blaine Beckham. And then I like, if you squint, I'm like right there. And we are discussing a piece. So yeah, I can't remember which workroom performance that was, but a couple years ago.
Looks like Sarah and Andre.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, I can't remember what year that was. I think it was like right after my MFA. Yeah, right after I moved back to Atlanta from getting my MFA. So yeah, so you want to hire the stage manager, and you want this to be a good person. You want this to be a cool person that everybody will listen to you. So how do you talk to your stage manager in that moment? Definitely the more communication, the better. And that's like at the hiring process, that's during the whole process, and that's at the end when everything comes down. You want to look at your stage manager as an artistic collaborator, because that's going to be, that's going to set you guys up in your relationship for the better. You definitely don't want to be afraid to talk about money. And we brought this up, and we say, hey, you definitely want to pay your stage manager. You definitely want to pay them what they're worth. You definitely want to have a budget for your show. And a lot of times that thought can sometimes trump the idea of realizing that you're still in a community and you can reach out and you can ask for help. It's one of the reasons why organizations like Dance ATL is so important, is because it helps build that community. So say your budget is very low and you want to hire a stage manager with all of these skills, please ask. Please be upfront and say, hey, this is what I'm working with. It could be a situation where, you know, that stage manager will tell you, hey, you know, we might be able to afford not all of the things on this list, but a few things on this list. Or it could be a situation where that person that you want to hire says, hey, I know a really, really good person who's within your budget, who's excellent, who's going to do what you're looking for at a lower price. So definitely reach out, have those conversations. Don't be afraid to talk about money. Don't be afraid to talk about budget, you know, really rely on your community and know that it's okay to ask for help. And this brings us to our next point about making sure that you're communicating that help throughout the process and not waiting until the tech week or even the day of the performance to bring up, you know, requests. Last minute requests will always be more difficult to fulfill. They're not necessarily impossible, but they're definitely more difficult. And it can be a situation where it'll cost you more money, especially if you're trying to keep that budget. You want to keep those things in mind. Make sure that, you know, if it's a festival or recital or a showcase, that, you know, you're checking in with your stage manager to make sure there's extra paperwork that's involved that may not necessarily be there for a one-and-done performance. And you definitely want to think about the important moments of your piece. Think about how you want it to be lit, how you want those sound cues to go, because your stage manager is going to need to know that information in order to make all of the things that you're looking for happen.
Yeah, it's always really refreshing to talk to a choreographer that you can tell has really thought about their piece and their vision and knows how to communicate that to me, because I'm always going to ask, you know, at the very start of tech, so how does the piece start? And it's always great when the choreographer can say, the dancers enter the space in the dark and then it's lights and sound together. Versus a lot of times that is exactly what is happening, but the choreographer just hasn't quite thought about it and doesn't really know how to iterate exactly what they want, and it ends up eating up a lot of time in tech, which is okay, but that tech time can be very valuable. So especially like any important moments, but especially the beginning and the end of the piece as well, are always going to be really important to think about and know how to communicate. And moving to our next slide, and sort of on this in the same vein of how to communicate with stage managers, after talking about all of the nuts and bolts of what stage managers do and why they're important and how to talk to them, I also wanted to share sort of my own personal philosophy as a stage manager, which is that I think that stage managers really are artistic and creatives, even though they're not always seen as that way. So often a lot of people don't consider stage managers artists. They think that it's strictly a management position, an administrative position, a technical position, because you don't see stage managers taking a bow and you don't see them in the review. And they're often not seen as collaborators. But I think that I'm creative in my job every day, and like I said in my introduction, I came from a dance background and I, you know, performed, and I found myself much more creatively fulfilled as a stage manager than I ever did as a dancer. And I wanted to share this quote that I read a few years ago that's sort of become my manifesto as a stage manager, just really stuck with me. It's a quote from the Steppenwolf production manager, Al Franklin, from a letter that he wrote to a student in response to a designer telling the student that stage managers were not artists and that they shouldn't be treated as so. And these are just excerpts from the full-length letter. It is hyperlinked here, the full letter, if anybody wants to read the whole thing. And like I said, Jackie will send this out after the presentation. But he says, to say a stage manager is not a collaborative theater artist because he or she is told what to do is akin to saying an actor isn't an artist because they are given their lines by the playwright and told by the director where and how to move. It's true that stage managers have to make use of certain technical skills to do their job, but that's no different than the technical skills required by a designer. Virtually all theater artists need certain technical skills, and virtually all theater artists are given specific direction. But to name the direction given to a designer as collaboration, while naming the direction given to a stage manager as something else, is just semantics. I disagree with anyone who doesn't recognize their stage manager as a fellow artistic collaborator. And then he goes on to say, I'd compare a stage manager running a show to a conductor conducting an orchestra. They both listen intently and use their experience and intuition to feel the moment when the show will benefit the greatest by calling the next cue. It's a subtle art and not simply a mechanical process of saying the word go when the actor utters a specific word. Directors and designers who collaborate with the stage manager to develop the best show possible are the ones who benefit the most. The stage manager must have, more than any other member of the team, a full understanding of the show, each actor, each set piece, each lighting and sound cue, and how each component, individually and collectively, moves through its individual moment. The stage manager's artistic ability and integrity are what ultimately transform the show from its pieces into that magical whole. And, of course, the author of this letter is speaking, as you can tell, about theater, but I think this applies just as much, if not more, to dance and really encapsulates what we've kind of been talking about this whole presentation, is that it's much more refined than just saying the word go. There's a lot more that goes into the job, and there's a lot more experience that you need behind that, and really intangible, finite skills that go into a good stage manager. And it's so much more interesting than just saying the word go when you're looking at a stopwatch. Genuinely enjoy my job. I find it to be a very creative outlet. While we were planning this talk, I was talking to Greg Catalier about this, and he reminded me of this time at ACDA where I was calling a piece that he had choreographed for the Emory Dance Company, and it was just on the cusp of being too long because ACDA has that 12-minute rule that if you go past the 12 minutes, it'll be disqualified and can't be considered for the gala. And I knew that going into it, and I knew that there was a speaking and a singing section in the middle of these two tracks of music. And so when that section got a little bit too long, we were in jeopardy of the piece going over 12 minutes. And that particular day, it was a full house, and the lines were a little bit funny, and the audience was laughing more than they usually do. And by nature, that was making the dancers take longer. And I saw that, like, I knew at what point we needed to start the second piece of music in order to keep it under 12 minutes. So I'm looking at my stopwatch and I see that we're getting close. And normally I'm supposed to call the second sound cue after a dancer finished singing. It was the Star Spangled Banner that she was singing out of key, and it was supposed to be when she dropped to the floor, the Jimi Hendrix cover, Star Spangled Banner, would come in. But instead, I knew that we were getting close, and I knew also that the final image of that piece was really important, and it was really important to Greg. So in the moment, this was not something that Greg and I discussed. It wasn't something we had planned, but in the moment, I knew that the best option was to take the cue early. So I took it when Leah started singing instead of when she finished. And the dancers adapted. They, you know, in the moment, made the best of it, and it worked out. And the piece was praised by the adjudicators. It made it into the gala, and it was great. And Greg was happy with the decision that I made for the piece. And it was partially a technical decision. Like, I was looking at my stopwatch, and I did know that we needed to start the next piece of music soon. But it was also an artistic decision because I was familiar with the work, and I knew that I didn't want to start it in the middle of Leah singing, and I knew that it made the most sense to start it where I started it. So it's not just a formula, it's not just a method of saying the word go when you have to. It's also a very fine judgment call that you have to make at times.
When Angelina and I were prepping for this talk, and she brought this quote to me, we actually read the whole letter, and it hit me because oftentimes I or a colleague of mine will be in a stage management position, and we're sometimes judged by how, you know, we look. I know that stocky male doesn't know the difference between a plié or a ponche, so of course he's not going to be a good stage manager. Or that small woman is, she doesn't look like she'll be able to command the room. And then, you know, before we share our experiences and our knowledge, we're almost kind of like pushed down. And it's like, oh, we're going to take care of the dance stuff, and all you're going to do is just call the cues, and don't worry about anything else. And it's important at this time that we're in, where people are unpacking racism and unpacking classism and sexism. They're doing that in a way to uproot toxic behavior or toxic experiences, to create new opportunities and new experiences that are uplifting and rewarding and successful for people. So this is really important. And it's our last point, but it's an important point to end on, because we want to make sure that we are cultivating the idea that you're not just hiring a person to, you know, gather your paperwork for you. You're hiring a fellow artist who's going to uphold your vision and carry it for you with integrity, with detail, with honesty, so that you can focus on your responsibilities as an artist director, as a choreographer, which is your vision. And so with that, we are going to turn it over to Q&A time. It's Q&A time. So if you have any questions, feel free to put them in the chat, or I don't know if you guys want to come off mute. You guys have been using the chat box a lot. And Scott, thank you so much for being our stage manager for this evening, and helping us smoothly communicate with our audience.
Yeah, totally. The questions are rolling in. And just to open it back up too, if you want to remain anonymous or ask something privately, I can, you know, not read names or anything. So it's totally open. I'll just start with the top. The first question that was asked was from Jackie. And it says, besides knowing the beginning and the end of a piece, what are some other things to have prepared when going into tech with your stage manager?
I think landmarks in the piece are always important. You know, when we're in tech, we're always looking for a good place to start and stop, a good place to take it from when we're looking at things over and over again. And also, you know, it's up to your designer to a degree at how they want to frame the piece, but you also want to have ideas in mind of, you know, if you know that you want a big lighting change somewhere, also think about how you can communicate that to a stage manager, how you can tell them what's coming right before that, or, you know, what a good landmark in the piece is.
Some technical things would be crossovers. You know, do you have people crossing over behind scenery in order to get to the other side during your piece? Another thing is, if it's a performance with multiple different pieces, say it's a showcase or it's a festival, and you have a dancer in one piece and then they come backstage for another, it's good to work out those quick changes. So that's a good conversation to have in that tech time, because that's a lot of logistics. You know, where's the quick change area going to be? How many dancers need to use that quick change area? A lot of times, quick changes need to be timed, so that while the transitioning on stage is happening with your crew, it's also happening with the dancers. So those are some things to think about.
Sorry, I decided to take off the screen share so we can see each other for conversation, if that's all right.
So the next question, my chat just moved now because we, okay.
Sorry.
So, no, it's all good. It's from Patton. And this one, I think, is in reference to your story about ACDA, I think. It says, in the example you just provided, Angelina, what do you feel your responsibility to the dancers and their potential vulnerability and expectations might be?
Yeah, so I mean, it's a lot of trust, right? So obviously, the dancers had to adapt. And I think as a stage manager, it's just your responsibility to know that level of risk. And I knew that what I was doing was obvious enough that they would know what to do. Like, they would know to get back on the music. But that was also just because I knew those dancers well. And I knew that it was going to be for the best. But obviously I wouldn't have done it had I not trusted them to do that. So
I think an obvious point to bring up is those dancers really knew Angelina, and Angelina really knew those dancers. There was a relationship that was cultivated long before the performance happened, so that in that moment, it's not like the dancers didn't know who was calling the show. It wasn't like I don't know what happened, the music changed, the light changed.
Like, they knew it wasn't a mistake.
Right, exactly, because they knew Angelina. And they knew and trusted her in the situation that she would be able to help them see that through. So that relationship is important. It goes back to the idea of making people feel comfortable in the space. Sometimes that could be headspace, that could be physical space, that could be performance space, and cultivating that relationship beforehand, before the lights go up, is so key. So that when those moments happen, like, people, you know, they go with you, they follow you.
Patton, does that kind of answer your question?
Yeah, definitely.
Cool. So the next one I see here is from Caroline. Caroline asks, can you talk a little bit about how to start getting work as a stage manager, as someone with just a dance background? Like, some first steps to getting into the stage management world.
Yeah, I think that being on the other side of stage management is a great way to start understanding it. Any work that you can do backstage, if you can start working as a stagehand or an ASM, there are also a lot of internships or apprenticeships that you get involved in. And really, like, shadowing stage managers and watching what they're doing and seeing how a show works before you try to call a show is really important. Greg's in the chat saying BDF internship. Yes. The Bates Dance Festival is a dance festival in Maine. They take interns every year, and there are a lot of dance festivals that happen every year that also take interns and apprentices, and you can, you know, ADF, you can go as both a dancer and a technician. But really just getting as much experience as possible, and then a lot of becoming a stage manager has much more to do with experience than it does like with anything that you could learn in a classroom. It's a lot of trial and error. It's a lot of, you know, we spend so much time talking about these instincts and like these things you have to develop, and there's no way to do it other than to experience these things, because every show is different. And every time something crazy happens on a show, you store that information and you take it with you to the next one. So every show is going to teach you something, and as much as you can experience before you're in those situations will help prepare you for that. And also just, you know, being in contact with as many stage managers as you can and learning from them and watching what people do and what you like and what you don't like. You can see what's successful and what's not. Yeah, and there are so many small projects going on in Atlanta. Like, people always need help. They always need people. So even if you don't have a lot of experience, there, you know, you can always volunteer, and there's always value in every one of those experiences. And that's what's going to get you paying jobs eventually.
To Angelina's point, you know, reach out to Jackie, reach out to FanCTO, reach out to your schools. Start emailing people. Even if it's just a question, even if it's just that question, hey, I'm really interested in getting this going, build a community for yourself. Also, think about the practical details of stage managing. Start making lists and checking off lists, which is a lot of what stage managing is. And yes, that's like really lists, like, yes, lists. How do you organize your thoughts? Do you journal? Do you have a binder? Do you have tabs in your binder? I mean, I'm being like super like specific, but cultivating those small skills can set you up to be successful in the long run while you're getting your feet under you, while you're getting those experiences, Angelina says, while you're interning. You can cultivate those things to build your skill level and build you up. And then people notice that. That's actually how I got into tech. I was in class and my professor, Anna Leo, she said, hey, I really noticed the way that you organize your binder for this class. It's very detailed. Are you interested in, and that's the beginning. And, you know, and Greg Cavalier, we were in the tech booth, and I was push and go for him, and I watched him stage manage, and that's history. So yeah,
it's all we do is make lists and herd people. Really, that's what it boils down to.
I'm gonna skip ahead just very briefly because I think this question is related. But someone asks, "Are stage managers usually part of a union?" Which I think is really related to looking for work as a stage manager. And then I'll go back. I think I missed David's question.
Yeah, so there are stage managers in unions. They absolutely can be. AGMA covers stage managers for dance and opera, and then Equity covers stage managers for theater. But they don't have to be. I don't have an AGMA card. I would maybe if I lived in a different city where there were more AGMA-based companies, but for all of the companies that I work for in Atlanta, it wouldn't help me as much, so I am not union, but you definitely could be. There are definitely pros and cons to being in a union.
Okay, so I'm going to jump back briefly. David asked, you talked a little bit about alternative spaces. What do you need to start thinking about when you're doing shows outside or in non-conventional spaces?
You definitely want to think about It's funny, like I'm reminded of a show that I did in a park, and one of the first things we did was me and the choreographer, we went to the park and we walked the space, and we figured out where everything was going to be, where the audience was going to be, where the performance space was, and from there we can kind of land like, okay, well, maybe this is where the tech booth is going to be, and maybe this is where dancers can have a space to warm up, and maybe this is where sort of kind of like landing that space, not necessarily mirroring what a theater is, but like nailing down some of those ideas before anybody else came into the space, and kind of put their spin on it. So that, you know, when designers came in, you can say, hey, I'm thinking that the tech booth is going to be here, and that the audience is going to be here, and the performers are going to be here, and then this is how it's going to go. You know, and as a stage manager, you know, you're going to need to know that information anyway. So already kind of knocking that out in the forefront is a good idea.
Yeah. Also, I mean, if you're outside, you got to think a lot about weather. How that's gonna play, and you're always gonna have a plan A, B, C, D, E for non-traditional spaces. Just bring all of the surprises, and you just always have to be ready to roll with it. You gotta think about, you know, are we doing a show during the day, or are we doing it at night? If we're doing it at night, then we're gonna need lighting, and then we need power, and, you know, then you get into generators, and you also got to think about, you don't have the normal things that you would normally have in a theater. Like, you need a table, you need a chair. Those are things that you don't normally have to think about because you have a tech table in front of you. Like Sharon said, you got to think about dressing spaces. Those are things that we're just used to always having in a theater. You got to think about where you're going to store stuff. You know, if it's outside, you probably don't want to leave all of your gear outside every night. Or like we just did a show at Emory in the Student Center because we can't do things in the theater because of spatial restrictions. And that off like comes with its own set of rules, respecting like a public space, and having to tear everything down and put it back up the next night. And then paperwork becomes even more important when you're putting up and tearing down every night. It's got to become like clockwork. Yeah, there are a million things to think about.
Yeah, and another thing to think about right off the top of my head, Angelina brings up a good point about paperwork, especially in a non-traditional space. As she said, that you might not have a table and a chair, which means you might not be able to put your binder on it and flip through and or write stuff down. So sometimes, you know, tapping into, you know, OneDrive or Dropbox or Google Suite, and becoming portable. Sometimes this is your binder, and you got to roll with it. You know, fanny packs are also your friend. That sort of thing. Again, Angelina, as she said it, like all of those traditional things that comes with a performance space with walls, all of a sudden you have to think about how to either reinvent, recreate, adapt, modify, or just throw out so that you can be in that outdoor, non-traditional space.
Safety is a big thing too, I feel like, with non-traditional spaces. There are often a lot of like safety concerns that it sounds like a super great idea to do this show in this really cool space, but not thinking about how safe it could actually be for dancers. And like that also goes back to weather. Like, you know, you shouldn't lay Black Marley in direct sunlight at 4 p.m. in Atlanta, or you'll end up taking dancers to the hospital with burns on their feet. And you shouldn't do shows in 30 degrees outside, or everyone will be sad. Does that kind of answer the question?
That was lengthy, but I hope we covered it.
That's a loaded question. question.
Be resourceful. David, do you feel complete about that? I'll keep an eye out for an answer. And then go ahead.
Yeah, I say that was good. I wanted something nice and open-ended. There's a lot to think about out there.
And then the last one I see here is from Jackie. It says, what is the most important item in your stage manager toolbox, sort of tangible or not? And what has helped you save the day in the past?
Okay, so the most important item in my stage manager toolbox, thank you, Greg Cattelier, is my pencil bag. I started off as a stage manager, and I will always steal his pencils from the tech booth to write down my cues. And I don't know if he said it out loud, you need to get to a point where you have your own stuff. But it became apparent that I needed to have my own stuff. And then that pencil bag became the bag where I put all my pens. It became the bag where I kept scissors. It became the bag where I kept markers, your black Sharpie for, white tape, your silver Sharpie for black tape. It accumulated into something more than just an implement so that I'm not taking Greg's pencil. It turned into an essential item that I'm always grabbing for. And it's on the go. So, it's an item that can fit into a backpack, a fanny pack, backpack. Well, probably not your backpack. You don't want to send on your pencils. Then I have to think about the second question. You might have to repeat it.
I think it was all one question, right? It was just like, it could be something physical or not.
Yeah, I was just thinking about a story, Sharon, you shared when we were doing like our little dress about being outside and having your notebook using a
pen. Yeah, I mean, between that and the notes, I think you were talking about the thing that saved me. People saved me. I don't stage manage in a vacuum. I'm not a superhero. I'm a human, and definitely working collaboratively has saved me. So having those conversations with choreographers and dancers have saved me. So yeah, the people that I work with in a lot of these situations are vital and key, and cultivating those relationships so that I'm not stage managing in a vacuum. I can't. And for those last minute requests, I have a network to rely on, so it's not just me.
I think if we're talking a physical favorite tool, it's hard to like pick like a, again, I feel like it depends on the show. If we're talking site specific work, definitely a headlamp. I always have a headlamp around my neck because you never know when you're going to be in the dark, and there's nothing more frustrating than like trying to pull out your cell phone flashlight. So I always have a light around my neck. Because your phone dies. I also really like my thermometer. I have a little digital thermometer that I usually have with me for shows, because dancers love to be like, oh my god, it's so cold. Oh my god, it's so, like, or it's too hot. And it's good to know exactly what temperature it is, so you can know if the dancers are just being dramatic or if you need to go tell the people in the venue that our rider says it needs to be at least this many degrees and it's not. And you can show them that it's not, and then they fix it, or they're in violation of your tech writer. So.
Yes, you tell them.
All right, y'all. And then we have a follow-up question to David Tattoo's last question from Patton, and we'll take this as our last question.
So this is a is based on an experience that we had with CORE in France a little over a year and a half ago. And it's about the site-specific thing. And we had, during the performance, we had an audience member decide that they wanted to become a part of the performing cast. And I'm just curious, I know what my reaction as stage manager was. I'm curious to hear what Angelina and Sharon, what you all would have done in the same situation.
I'm almost curious as to what your reaction was.
You know, it was obviously going back to your, you know, just the lists that you make and trying to anticipate everything that might happen is certainly even more heightened when you're working in site specifically or just out in the public realm, because you don't have the same level of control of what the audience, where the audience is, what they're going to be doing, all that sort of stuff. And, you know, knowing Sue and, you know, and this was sort of the artistry piece, I made the decision to just let it play out like it was, however it was going to, and felt that I trusted the dancers to handle it. But then that wasn't the case when the show was over and the dancers were sharing with me what they experienced. So what would you all have done?
Unexpected audience performances during performances are so tricky, especially in the moment. I think it's one of the reasons why Emory Dance has that person that's posted in the back by the bathrooms, because how many times has someone walked out on stage thinking that they were, you know, trying to enter, you know, the audience to sit down. It's so difficult in that moment. It's like, do you ask an ASM to gently guide someone off, or, you know, do you let it play out, let it become, you know, part of the performance? There are instances where, you know, you as a stage manager will make a decision and then it gets back to you that, hey, that wasn't what we wanted. But, you know, I still applaud the decision and know that, sometimes it's like, oh, okay, well, that didn't work out. But also think about the idea of, you know, that audience member. They may or may not, they definitely didn't plan it. And so there's a little bit of a fear factor in there. And there's a little bit of anxiety of, especially if it's a person who's not typically a performer, you know, there's stage fright involved. So there's that deer in the headlight situation. So, you know, it's the reminder that, you know, everybody's human, everybody's, you know, people. And yes, your piece is important. Yes, it's important to keep the integrity of the work, keep the integrity and the vision. And it's also important to take care of people. So, you know, it could be that moment of, oh, we got a deer in a headlight situation. Hey, can you gently guide this off? Or hoping that, you know, one of the dancers makes it, you know, a part of the performance. And again, it goes back to that relationship between the stage manager and the dancer and the choreographer. That's also very key.
Yeah, my response would probably be similar. You kind of got to read the room. When something crazy like that happens, I think the moment I would probably draw the line was if I felt like the dancers were in any kind of danger, then I would definitely, somebody would be stepping in. But I could understand, like, Patton's approach, like, if you thought it would be more obstructive to the piece to have to escort somebody away, then, and it, especially if it's an informal type site-specific work like that. I mean, it would be a completely different story if I'm calling a valet at the Fox and somebody hops up on stage. I'd be on a radio in a second, you know, having security escort them out. But it's also tough when you're, you know, maybe you don't have an ASM or there isn't somebody close to you to help you, you know, if you're already calling a show. That's a tough call, so. I don't think there's a right or wrong answer.
Yeah, Sammy added here, gauge safety versus artistic integrity. Yeah, I like that. All right, y'all, well, that is all the time we have for the Q&A. Karen and Angelina, thank you so much. Y'all are both a wellspring of information.
Yes, thank you to you both and you too, Scott, for your time and talent with this tech talk. And if you all have more questions, feel free to send them my way to info@danceatl.org, and I will bring it to Sharon and Angelina to answer for you. If you have to head out, feel free to run off. I just have a couple quick announcements. One, again, we'll be sending this PowerPoint presentation to y'all along with a recording within the next couple of days. If you want to stay in touch with all things Dance ATL, there's a couple of things you can do, like follow our social media, which Scott is dropping in the chat. Also, you can sign up for our dance newsletters that go out every week and we work really hard on. So you can sign up for the emails by going to danceatl.org and scrolling down and plugging in your email. Lastly, you can also make a donation to us via donor box. Core Dance is our fiscal sponsor, and as a 501c3, they can accept donations on our behalf. So if you're, you know, if you like what we're doing and you like our programming, please feel free to support us so we can continue doing that. Again, thank you again to you three for being here and providing this awesome workshop to everyone. It was so informative and jam-packed and wonderful. So it was nice seeing some familiar faces and meeting new faces as well. Thank you again. And we'll stick around for maybe the next 2 or 3 minutes to answer last minute questions for those who want to stay behind. But otherwise, enjoy the rest of your night and have a lovely
dinner. Thank you, everyone. Have a great night.
Thanks, y'all.
Hey, Sally.
Hi, Aubrey. I'm sad I don't get to play with you this week, but I think I'll be there next week, okay?
Next week. All right. Yeah. Good night, you guys.
Bye.